about New Zealand earlier and the bumper budget that was handed down yesterday. The federal budget across the Tasman returning to surplus, the first in 7 years. Now, not only was that New Zealand surplus bigger than expected, but the government flagged the possibility of future tax cuts and new spending. A tweet from PwC tax partner Jeff Nightingale says, "This is the budget Australia will be hoping for in 2018. So why is our current story so different from New Zealand's? I'm joined now by Lee White. He's from the Institute of Chartered Accountants, and he's joining us from Sydney. Good morning to you, Lee. Thanks so much for joining us.
Good morning.
Missing in that whole intro is obviously the backdrop of the Australian budget this year. So Bill English, the New Zealand finance minister, is saying that really it was the austerity and the tough decisions that were taken from 2008 to now that has put the budget bottom line there in such good shape. But we're not really comparing apples and apples, are we, when we're talking about New Zealand versus Australia?
Quite clearly not, because you've got two different countries with two different economic cycles and two different drivers of how their economies actually operate. But the important message here, Nadine, is to actually look across the Tasman and consider or benchmark what are the fundamentals that are different and asking the real questions, why are they so different, and is there something that Australia should be changing in order to make sure that it's top of its game?
Okay, so fundamentally, what is New Zealand doing right, or is the question, what has Australia done wrong?
Well, let's break it down to simple terms. Budgets is money in through taxes and money out through government expenditure. So what we look on the revenue side, the money coming in, is that New Zealand has taken the steps in recent years to actually change its GST scope and rate. And we know in Australia that's a very sensitive issue, and in times past we've actually called to make sure that the politicians in Australia relieve themselves of any promises not to include GST. So first and foremost, Australia needs a broader review of its taxation system, and GST needs to be fundamentally part of that. Secondly, I would also look towards the tax rates, particularly for individuals. With the deficit levy being introduced, you'll see the highest marginal rate in Australia being 49% for individuals. That is significantly more than New Zealand, and therefore you've got to ask again, is there something here that's out of whack? And it would appear so, and we need to make sure that Australia retains the right talent. In terms of expenditure, then we start asking our questions, have we actually drawn enough cost-cutting across in Australia in this budget?
Okay, and I guess I can imagine what you believe about the GST. Do you think that the government has brought this fight to the states with intent to get GST on the table? Do you think that there is the political will, and I guess perhaps more importantly, support amongst the Australian public to eventually see this GST conversation being had in real terms in time to sort of bring this budget back to surplus in line with the government's forward forecasts?
Breaking that down, yes, I do. I think the Australian public will have a mature approach to the debate around GST. But importantly, Nadine, it can't be just about that. We need to make sure that there is a wide-ranging review of taxation, not just the element of GST. But many saw a few years ago with the Henry Review, where GST wasn't included in the terms of reference, most felt that that was very limiting.
I'm interested too in this debt levy, because it appears as if in Bill Shorten's budget reply speech that the fact that it wasn't mentioned as a fight with the government, that they won't be opposing this this so-called debt levy. In New Zealand, what are the lessons that we've learned there when it comes to levies? Because if I'm correct, there was no rebuilding levy in the wake of even the Christchurch earthquakes there. So do you think that that could prove to be a mistake going forward?
Look, from an Australian perspective, we've had a history of levies at times, the most recent probably being the Queensland floods. But I think generally levies are short-term fixes, band-aid approaches. And what I believe is more important for this country's economic development is approach which is more tackling the mid to long-term issues. So in effect, you're not going to get the right match between a short-term levy and a mid-term or longer-term challenge. Levies don't necessarily work, and I think what they do leave is the taxpayers believing, well, what actually occurred, rather than understanding the full reach of what could be delivered.
Okay, so the overriding lesson to be learned then from New Zealand's experience in comparison to Australia's?
I would say there's a couple of things. That at times when you are in challenging economic conditions, in deficits, take an approach which is disciplined, but also one which has a focus on the medium-term outcomes, not necessarily for tomorrow.
And did this, the Abbott government's first budget, how would you rate it, scale of 1 to 10? Did it go far enough?
We believe it was a strong debut by the Treasurer in delivering his first budget, and so we would certainly see it as a 6.5 to potentially a 7. A good debut, but much stronger work needs to be done, particularly in taxation reform.
Lee White, a pleasure having you on. Thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you.
Lee White is the CEO of the Institute of Chartered Accountants, and he was joining us from Sydney. We're taking